This session now will prove the convergence of the Euler scheme. So we will prove the strong convergence. What's actually nice from the proof is that you get maybe a bit more intuition of what the Euler scheme solution is. We already had this. So we are in the section time discretization of stochastic processes. We have defined the Euler scheme. We have defined weak and strong convergence. And before we started, we actually observed that we can define a stochastic process. Here it's this dx tilde superscript n that is an Itô process with piecewise constant coefficients. And the values of this Itô process at the time discretization points are the Euler scheme approximations. So the nice thing is that we now compare two stochastic processes. When I like to prove strong convergence, I now compare two stochastic processes, and I compare here now x of t, the true solution, and x tilde of t, the Euler scheme approximation, as to x tilde superscript n with a certain time discretization step, taking the difference of the two absolute value, taking the supremum over all times. And that's a random variable. The expectation of this random variable can be estimated by the time step size. So it becomes smaller if the time step size becomes smaller. And this is now the result I like to prove. So the assumption is that my coefficients are Lipschitz continuous, mu and sigma. They fulfill here this condition 17, Lipschitz continuity. And then I can estimate this error term here by time step size to the power of 1/2. So first step in the proof is that I can actually consider x minus x tilde squared. So I will explain why I like to consider x minus x tilde squared. But if I look at x minus x tilde squared, then it's enough to prove that this is less or equal. So supremum over the difference expectation is less or equal a constant times h. Because if I have here order one, so less or equal a constant time h, then I can use the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Using f equals 1. So this means expectation of g is less than expectation of 1 squared is just 1, is less than expectation of g squared to the power of 1/2. Okay, so if I now prove that this here is the g squared, if now the g squared, expectation of g squared is less than h, then I have proven that expectation of g, f is equal to 1, is less than h to the power of 1/2. So Cauchy-Schwarz inequality tells me I can also look at this here, where the g, the function g, is actually the supremum of x minus x tilde. And here I have moved the squared inside the supremum. But actually that's the same. So because there is an absolute value, the supremum of the squared values is the same as the supremum of the absolute values squared. Okay, so it's a bit nicer to consider the square here, because at one point I will need Doob's Martingale inequality, and there I have a property for a square. Okay, so how do I prove now this thing? The expectation of the supremum of the difference of the two random variables squared is less than a constant times h. What is this? X of t minus x tilde of t. Well, I can plug in the SDEs. So this is the initial values. So it's the difference of the initial values plus integral from 0 to t mu t x of t. And then, of course, minus the integral of mu tilde. So let's have a different letter. So don't use t here. Let's take maybe s. Plus the integral sigma dw minus sigma tilde dw. If I like to estimate now this, maybe I can use here the Lipschitz continuity. So what is mu tilde s? Mu tilde s is mu at some point ti x tilde ti. So it is the same as mu, but at the shifted time point, slightly shifted, yeah, because ti is now the interval where s is in ti to ti plus one, and at a different value, x tilde of ti. So if I use now here the Lipschitz condition, then maybe I can estimate this guy like s minus ti plus x of s minus x tilde of ti. Okay, that's a bit ugly because it is a different value and a different time. So maybe I can here use the same time. And then I have again plus x tilde of s minus x tilde of ti. So you see I have three terms. I have something that is of order h, something that is the difference of the two stochastic processes at the same time, and something that is the difference of the Euler scheme process at two different times. So maybe this here is again of order h. And what you see here is that you have here the same stuff as you have here under an integral. So this is an integral over ds. And maybe this rings a little bell, because this looks a little bit like Cronwall's lemma. You have a function that is estimated against an integral over the function. Okay, so let's have this as a sketch of the proof. Yeah, so you get the main idea. And then you also see why I need a few lemmas, which I will just cite. So from the definition of the stochastic process, so that's just what I wrote before, I can now look at x of s minus x tilde of s, and I can represent this as this integral. And we have here that this part inside the integral, if I take absolute value, it can be estimated against tau minus ti. This is of order h plus x of tau minus x tilde of tau plus x tilde of tau minus x tilde of ti. So the same stochastic process as at two different times. Okay, so maybe here it's also of order h. Well, it will not be of order h. It will be shown that this is order h 1/2, but I still have the square. Yeah, there is a square here around this. Yeah, so it will be then later in order h. And here I have the same thing as on the left-hand side, but just under the integral. So this looks as if I can nicely apply Cornwall's inequality. So what is Cornwall's inequality? If you have a function and you know that the function is finite, and you have an estimate that the function can be estimated by a plus b times the integral over the function itself, then you know that the function is less than a times exponential b times t. Now you can bound the function by this exponential function. And I like to use this with the expression where the function u is exactly the error term, well, the one with the square. This guy here is the term that we had here from the strong convergence, but with the square, okay? So what we need to do is actually, so we are looking at this guy here, what we need to do is we need to estimate this by an h. So I would like to have that my function u is less or equal h times a constant. And I have that if, for example, my constant a is c times h, because then here I have for the constant a here some h in front, and b can be any constant. So b can be any constant. The constant c is allowed to depend on time, because then I just plug in here capital T. So this is less than taking the largest possible point in time, b times t. Yeah. So this is of order. So this is of order h. Yeah, because a is c times h. So you see that Cornwall's lemma tells me that it is enough to have some constant times h plus some other constant, an integral over the function again. And you see that I have something like this. I have here on the left-hand side this guy. Here I have an integral over the guy again, and I have plus some stuff that is of order h. So whenever I have a stuff that is of order h, I can move it out with a plus. And as long as the other stuff is an integral of the function that was on the left-hand side, I'm fine. Of course, here on the top, I only looked at x as minus x tilde. And here I have actually a much more complicated expression. I have expectation of the maximum of the square of the absolute value, but that's not a big problem. So for the absolute value, you will have an absolute value here, and you can just move this absolute value inside here and you make it just larger. I'm working for an estimate, I make it larger. I can move the absolute value inside the interval, inside the integrals, and that makes it also again larger. So that's no problem. So then I have here a squared, yeah, but I can move the squared from the outside to the inside using Cauchy-Schwarz inequality again. Then I have here a maximum. So if I take a maximum over all those values, I have a maximum here over all times, but I can move the maximum also inside, because integrating and then taking the maximum with respect to the upper bound is the same as integrating the maximum and taking the largest possible upper bound. So I can also move the maximum inside. And then I have an expectation operator, and that's also not an issue because I can use Fubini to swap expectation and the integral. And that was maybe already the proof. Okay, so let's do that. Let's work on this and prove the weak convergence by using Cornwall's inequality. I need a few things, and for these things, I will now review some results. I need that this function is finite. I do not know if this guy here is finite, and I do not know if this guy here is finite. So that's actually a lemma. So there is a lemma. When you have some condition on the quotes, then you know that these moments here are finite. So I need this lemma for Cornwall's inequality. Then I need this part here. If I have a stochastic process at two different time points, where the time points are close, then the two random variables here are close. Well, close in the sense order of h. So I need a lemma that tells me that. And this is the Lipschitz continuity of E2 processes. So if you have the Lipschitz condition for the coefficients, you have that a stochastic process evaluated at two time points where the time points are close, then the difference of the two random variables is small. Actually, if you take the square, it is smaller than t minus s. Okay, so this is, if I take the square here, it will be an h. Okay, so that's a lemma. And then I was just talking about the dt part. So I illustrated to you how we will treat the dt part. Of course, I have also here the stochastic integral with the dw. So I need a little bit to convert the integral dw to a dt integral. And this will be Doob's martingale inequality, which tells me if I have a martingale is some sigma dw. So if I have some sigma dw here and I take the maximum over it, there will be the maximum inside, then it's enough to just look at the last point. So here I have a w of t. And if I have a w of t squared, then I have the E2 isometry. If I have an integral over that, so the other guy was the maximum, this is now the integral. If I have an integral over some dw squared, then this is like having an integral over a dt. So the w square is an integral over dw squared. So this is the same as the integral over dt. Okay, so we need some estimates for stochastic processes. And let me go through this now in more detail, step by step. So I need the existence of moments of E2 processes and their Euler scheme. So why I need this? Because the Cornwall inequality requires that the stuff is finite. So if the coefficients mu and sigma have at most linear quotes. So this is now an important additional assumption here. So what does linear quotes mean? So it means there exists a constant C such that mu and sigma are bounded by C times 1 plus absolute value of x. So they do not have quotes in the x component that is larger than linear. If I have this, then there exists a constant k such that for p larger or equal 2, I have that the moment supremum x to the power of p, taking the expectation, is bounded, is finite. And the same, of course, here for the Euler scheme. Well, actually, I could just define it with one stochastic process because the Euler scheme is also just a process. I need it here for both because then I have that the difference is also finite. So we will use this for p equals 2. So with the linear quotes, maybe it's nice to recall what happens to an ODE, yeah? So an ordinary differential equation. So just where you have the dt and not the dw, okay. If you have linear or stronger than linear quotes. So if I have linear quotes, my coefficient is something that depends on x. Yeah, and if you have, for example, dx equals rx dt, then you know the solution of this is just exponential rt, yeah, multiplied with the initial value. Okay, if you differentiate this, you see this is the solution of this differential equation. If you have now a quote that is stronger than linear, say, for example, I have rx squared, so consider dx is rx squared dt, then the solution of this is, and you can easily check it, 1 divided by x0, initial value, minus rt. Well, if you differentiate this, you get here 1 divided by this guy squared. Yeah? So you get x squared multiplied with a minus 1, yeah, because it is differentiating minus 1 divided by. So then you also get a minus r, so you get a plus x squared, yeah? Plus 1 divided this by this stuff squared. So you see that this is the solution. And indeed, for t equals 0, this is just x0. And you have that this guy here explodes for t equals 1 divided by x0 times r. Okay, because then the stuff is 1 divided by 0. Okay, so this will explode in finite time. So you see that it's a reasonable assumption to have here linear quotes of the coefficients, because otherwise I couldn't even expect from the dt part of the SDE that the solution exists for all times. So I need this little lemma that the solution stays finite. Then I need the Lipschitz continuity of Itô processes. So if the coefficients satisfy a Lipschitz condition, then I can estimate the difference of the stochastic process at two different times squared by the difference of the times. Okay, so I need this little lemma. Then for the treatment of the TW part, I need Doob's martingale inequality. So if X is a martingale, so X is a martingale, that means that actually dx is just a sigma dw. Okay. Then if you look at the maximum of x of t to the power of p over all times, you can estimate this, the expectation of this, by the expectation of x of t at the final time point. So how does this look like? So I have a martingale here. So I start at some value and it goes like that. Huh? It may happen that the sigma becomes smaller after a certain time. So it can happen that it becomes like that. Yeah. So then the paths do not wiggle so much around. Then it can happen that the sigma becomes larger again. So then the sigma will become larger again. So paths also go down here. Yeah. Like that. But you see that, okay, I'm drawing it like that, yeah, but it's always getting wider. And this lemma is just telling me that for p larger than one, this is just becoming wider in the sense that if I look here at the maximum over all those values here, Yeah, and I take the expectation. So it actually for p equals 2, this is the variance. Yeah. So the then I can estimate this here by the last value at capital T with some constant in front. Okay, so we need this guy in the proof. And I need here the Ito isometry. So again, if you look at the martingale, so here it is dx is phi dw. So if you then look at x of t minus x of s squared, this is the same as the integral from s to t phi dw squared. So then the expectation of this is equal to the expectation of the integral of phi squared. So this will actually remove the dw or replace the dw by a dt, and we can then estimate the dw part in the same way as we have estimated the dt part. Now let's quickly finish the proof. Having these little helpers, these lemmas. So the main idea is clear. We try to work towards Kronwald's inequality. And we start here with the expression on the left-hand side, which we like to estimate. So the expectation of the maximum of x of s minus x tilde of s squared. Take the maximum over all values s between 0 and t. And I would like to estimate this by some h. So the estimate with the Kronwald is then this is my function u of t, u of little t. So I would like to have something like h plus the integral over the thing again. Okay, so I can plug in here as the first step, the definition of x of s minus x tilde of s in terms of the stochastic process. Yeah. So this is the x0 minus x tilde of 0 plus integral from 0 to s dx minus dx tilde of s. So nothing happened. Then I can estimate the square here. So I have a square here using this nice little formula here. So a plus b plus c squared can be estimated by 3 times a squared plus b squared plus c squared. Okay, so that's an easy estimate. And I use it here for a being my difference of the initial values, b being my integral part with mu, and C being my integral part with the sigma. Okay, so the initial value is already 0. Okay, so this guy here is okay. If the scheme starts in the same initial value, there's nothing to do. So I just have to treat the two integrals. So let's start with the integral over mu. And you remember from my motivation or from my sketch of proof, I now have to work in all the elements. Yeah. So I have to work in the squared to become under the integral. So I can again here use Cauchy-Schwarz. So this here is again the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality to move the square from the outside of the integral to the inside of the integral. The next step is to move the maximum. Yeah? So, but instead of moving the maximum inside, I can just drop the maximum and use the upper bound because I'm integrating here an absolute value. Okay, so if I integrate an absolute value, I make it larger, and then I can remove the maximum and just take here the upper bound capital T. Yeah, a little bit brutal, but that's okay. Now I can apply my Lipschitz condition for the difference here of mu, mu of the true solution and mu tilde of the Euler scheme. So we already did this. We get three terms. The difference in time. And I get, of course, so actually we get from the Lipschitz, we get two terms, the difference in time and the difference in space. But I add another term to the difference in space. So I have a difference in time, a difference of x of tau and x of ti. So the same stochastic process with different times, and x of ti minus x tilde ti. So the same time, but two different stochastic processes. And I already have collected here one of those H's, this guy, which is nice for the Cornwall lemma. This guy here is okay because it is just the same stuff as on the left-hand side. Okay, and this here should be estimated. Yeah, okay, so what's that? Okay, it will show it is order H 1/2, but we still have a square here. So I will have a square here. So it will become an order H. Okay, so if I now have here the square, I can again apply here my little formula. Yeah, I have a square of three sums. This is smaller than three times the sum of the squares. Okay, so I have h squared times t. Okay, so y times t, because now I'm integrating also. So I'm now applying the square, I'm integrating, and I'm applying the expectation. Expectation of a constant doesn't matter. So here I get h squared times t. So the t comes now from integrating. Here I have expectation of the integral, and the integral is now written as a sum of the integrals over the intervals from the time discretization. Why? Yeah, because here I always need to use the correct ti. And then also the expectation of the integral of the square of this guy, that was the third term on the previous slide, on that slide, the third term. Okay, so now we have these three guys. This part here, together with the expectation, can be estimated now with our lemma, the Lipschitz continuity of a stochastic process, by k times the difference of the two time points. But the two time points are from the same interval. Tau is in ti, 2ti plus 1. So k times h. And the integral here, this is just estimated by a capital T, right? So together with the sum. So some capital T is some constant. So it's some constant times h, yeah, if I integrate over this. Here for this part, I can use, I already mentioned that, a Fubini to swap the expectation and the integral. And you see that now I have a form that is like what I need for Cornwall's lemma. I have on the left-hand side the function, which I like to bound. It's a function of t. So this here will become my u of t with this t. And on the right-hand side, I have some h and an integral over the function again. So that's Cornwall lemma. This here was only the mu part. So now let's estimate the stochastic integral term. So I have here the sigma part, but from the Martingale inequality, I have that the maximum of this Martingale can be estimated by the last time point. So this here is the last time point. And from the Ito isometry, I can estimate the square, or I have even that the square of this is equal to a dt. Okay, so I can actually estimate the stochastic integral part by something which looks exactly like what I did for the mu. So I can repeat the previous step and get the same estimate. So together we have now an estimate that is exactly of this form that we need for Kronwald's lemma, where u is the error term from the strong convergence theory. So last step, apply Kronwald's inequality, and you have that u is bounded by a times exponential bt, where a, this guy a here, is actually something that has a c times h, has a h. So I have a bound with some h. Okay, that's it. We are done. So that was the proof of the strong convergence of the Euler scheme. Next thing is weak convergence, and for that I need Feynman-Katz theorem and Ito's lemma. Also a very nice proof, and we will do this in the next session.